Hello.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you guys for all coming here to this TWI presentation by Dr. Phil Colarusso. He actually got his PhD dissertation, doing his dissertation work on eelgrass in Menemsha, and he's a research scientist working for the EPA. He's in the Boston office, and he is instrumental in organizing an annual eelgrass meeting. It's in March, the middle of March. We didn't get to go this year because of problems with the Bourne Bridge, tractor trailer spilt. Like, there was a huge oil spill over there, so that's why we didn't get to make it that day. But anyway, and he organizes these meetings with a bunch of people all over New England, you know, basically helping them with their eelgrass issues and restoration problems and all that. And I'm going to let Phil take it away. All right.
Thank you for the invitation for coming down. I always like to come to the Vineyard. Been coming here sampling eelgrass in the ponds on and off since probably 1995. And I've probably spent more time swimming in some of these ponds than some of the residents. And let's see if I can figure out how to advance the slides. All right. Do you want to sit? Yeah, could you? Dr. Phil, the one with hair and does not have a TV show, and I don't care about your feelings. go ahead. I work for EPA. I've been there for 26 years, and I do a variety of things, but eelgrass is my area of expertise. For those who are unfamiliar with our topic, this is what a typical eelgrass meadow will look like in New England. This was taken in Gloucester, Mass. And, you know, you can tell the water's a little bit green and there's algae growing on the vegetation. But that's, you know, what a typical meadow looks like in New England. This is the Mediterranean. So I'm now showing you my vacation pictures. And this is a species of seagrass called Posidonia, which is closely related to the species we have here, which is Ostra marina, or eelgrass. And could you go back for 1 second? And so you can see how clear the water is, schools of fish. This is really lush meadow, thick, goes for acres and acres and acres. And when you think of seagrass meadows, that's typically what you think of. That's your mental image. This was taken in off of Cannes, France. And the French, and I'm going to talk a little bit about them more at later when we get into moorings and boats. They refer to seagrass as les poumons de la mer, which translates to the lungs of the sea. And so they're very concerned about conserving this resource because it does add oxygen to our waters, among other things. Next slide. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the morphology of the plant and some natural history, the ecology of the seagrass meadows, why do we care about them, what do they do for us, threats to those meadows, the general population trends. I think I have maps, some of the state aerial maps from Tajmu and the Vineyard. How do you restore it, or can you restore it? Next. And what can you do as a citizen? Okay. So I have this slide, but better yet, I brought some that we were sampling today. And typically it grows like the grass. Think about the grass on your lawn. So it has a long below ground structure called the rhizome with roots hanging down. And that does a couple of things. It holds the plant, secures it into the ground, but it's also the site where the plant absorbs a lot of its nutrients through the roots. The above ground structure, out here I think are measuring them at about 40 centimeters as 40 centimeters long. I've measured plants in the Piscataquis River in New Hampshire that were 9 footers. So a lot of it varies on the water depth they're growing in, the water movement. The one in the Piscataqua, people familiar with the Piscataqua River, it has a 2-knot current. So that plant was actually growing in fairly shallow water, but it spent its entire life kind of like this or like this, depending on the tide, not like this. The plants out here, you know, grow straight up because there's very little current in some of these ponds. But they grow inside out. It's kind of like a conveyor belt. So if you peel these back, you'll find there's 5 or 6 or 7 leaves per shoot. So each one of these is a shoot. And the new shoots grow in the middle of the plant. And that's it's convenient for us because we measure growth. And we do it in a very, very high-tech method. We take a safety pin, and we put a hole in the plant. And the outside leaves don't actually grow. Once they get to be these older leaves, they don't grow. The inside leaves do. So you come back in a week, 10 days, 2 weeks, and that little pinhole that you put through the plant will migrate on the inner leaves. The outer leaves will stay in place, so they're good reference points. But then just like marking a tree, you can actually measure growth over time. So that's probably one of the reasons I got into studying seagrass was I needed something that was very inexpensive to study. And if you have PVC, a couple of mesh bags, and a few safety pins, you can do a lot. Next slide. All right, so as I said, it's a rooted aquatic plant. It grows in shallow water, basically from the intertidal zone. I think on this coast, off of the coast of Rhode Island, people have seen it as deep as 11 meters. I'm not sure you'd find it there now, but historically. It grows on this coast from North Carolina up through Canada. On the west coast, it grows all the way down in the Gulf of California, in Mexico, up to Alaska, and that's because it's a cold water plant, and the Pacific is colder than the Atlantic. So it has a wider distribution on that coast. It reproduces two ways. It asexually, like the grass in your lawn, it will send out lateral shoots that will form their own upright shoots, and it actually produces seed. And Sherry and Danny and I and a few others were out collecting seeds in Tajmu yesterday. And a lot of the plants are flowering. The neat thing about it is you think about how that process may actually work. You're underwater, there's no birds, there's no bees. The plants somehow are able to fertilize the seeds just through movement of water current, etc. And they produce viable seeds that are actually quite tasty. We had Danny taste some yesterday. One of the reasons we care about this species, or one of the uses for this species, is it's an indicator. It has the highest light requirement of any aquatic plant species. Generally, people say you need about 20% of the ambient light or greater for the plant to survive. You probably need even more than that for it to successfully complete its life cycle. So the 20% limit allows the plant to persist like this, it won't die. But for it to successfully produce viable seeds, it probably needs closer to 50%.
Water perfectly clear, it would be 100%?
No, no. Even clear water is not 100%.
What is clear water?
You'd have to define clear. But you think about the tropics, it's probably 60 or 70% tops. So it doesn't take much to reduce that number. And the other aquatic plant species that we're familiar with, kelps, macroalgae, they need about 5%. Phytoplankton needs about 1%. So obviously, if you're protecting eelgrass, you're protecting all those other species as well. It grows in a wide variety of sediments, but it does best in soft. So some combination of silt and sand is best, but it can grow into cobble as long as it can get its roots into some soft sediment as well. and it grows from brackish water, so less than full saline, to truly marine waters. And actually, it physiologically does better in the brackish water, but it tends to be outcompeted by other species. It also prefers the same location that where people like to put their boats, in quiescent protected areas. There's a map, I think, later on in the talk, and if I left it in there, I hope I did, showing you the entire coast of Massachusetts and where eelgrass grows. And it's basically, good segue. So each one of these squares are areas where the state of Massachusetts, Mass DEP, has done an aerial survey looking for eelgrass. And you notice, first, notice the areas where they're not looking. So the Outer Cape, parts of the Outer South Shore, inner Cape Cod Bay, basically any place that has a true northeast exposure. And that's just because winter storms are too rough. And they would uproot the vegetation and they prevent it from growing any area that has a true northeast exposure. These locations are in protected. One of those is Cohasset, so it grows in the harbor in Cohasset behind a breakwater. The other is Scituate, it also grows in the harbor. Plymouth and Duxbury, it grows inside the harbor. There's a little bit outside, but very little. There's a meadow in Cape Cod in Sandwich near the Cape Cod Canal that grows behind the breakwater. And then everything else in Cape Cod Bay, there's a large meadow in Billingsgate Shoals, which grows kind of within the shadow of the rest of the Cape. South side of the Cape, Buzzards Bay, wonderful habitat historically for eelgrass. The ponds and the islands, protected, quiescent, wonderful habitat for eelgrass. I live up here. So there's some spots in Salem Sound and on Cape Ann, and a few spots in Nahant and Swampscott where large meadows grow, but all of them are protected out of the northeast. And so they're all in areas that are protected from the weather where people would also like to keep their boats. Next slide. So this is obviously the Vineyard, and this is the state, Mass DEP, their aerial mapping effort, and I throw this up there just to give you an idea that either historically, and the colors represent different years, unfortunately DEP is not able to do all over the island every year at the same time, which would be ideal. The green kind of speckled color is the most recent data that they have up on the state website. And that's from 2013. And so we see some in Menemsha. I don't know why, they never seem to map Stonewall. And I know from firsthand experience, there's eelgrass here. They have a bunch along the coast, some in Tajmu, some in Lagoon. I think there's actually a dot there in Sendikatakit, and a few other spots, but the gold color, I believe, is from 2006, and the pink is maybe 2010. Next slide.
How accurate is the aerial mapping?
We tell people that the aerial mapping is a great first step. So I've been involved with multiple projects, mostly like natural gas pipelines or fiber optic cables. Where people want to put something in the water, and they use these maps as their guide for deciding where they're going to do the construction. And we've told them, told multiple companies that these are good first approximations, but for project specific, you need to go out and do a dive survey. There's different objectives. Aerial photographs are great if you have to cover a large area, but they have their limitations. If the water's cloudy or the water's deep, you won't pick up the vegetation. So if you want a really accurate picture, you need to do it either from a boat, and we're now doing a lot of our mapping with acoustics towed from a boat. although we still rely on divers too, and divers and GPS to do mapping as well. In fact, we did some in Lagoon today that were that way. So this is obviously Tajmu and Drew's Cove and the flats up here. Again, the green is 2013 data. I want to say that's 2010, the brown. But the reason I put this up is for two things. One, the distribution changes on an annual basis. And some of that is natural and some of it is not. And it comes, it can disappear, and it can come back. And the reasons for that vary depending on the location and in the year. So I expect we'll have some questions about that at the end here. Next slide. Okay, so why do we care about eelgrass in the first place? Well, it's an important complex habitat for fish and shellfish. In the mid-90s, I did a survey with the New England Aquarium further north, Boston, Cape Ann, and we caught 34 different species of fish, everything from little sticklebacks to juvenile sand tiger sharks in the eelgrass. So they use it for refuge, they use it for spawning, they use it for foraging. And I actually have, this is the meat and the potatoes part of the presentation. I have a video, which is the dessert at the end, which hopefully it will play. We have, because it is Martha's Vineyard, there's sharks in the video as well. Next slide. It's an important primary producer, so it's the base of the food chain. And I'm sure everyone is familiar with how the food chain works. If the base is not productive, the upper tiers are not productive either. So it's important for that purpose. It filters the water. It absorbs pollutants, it absorbs nitrogen, but also just the physical presence of the leaves causes particles and other things to settle out of the water and thus cleanses it. Next. Reduces erosion, so the root and rhizome structure not only hold the plant into the ground, but they hold the sediments in place. And there's been many studies that have shown once you lose the eelgrass, the nature of the sediments change. All that soft sediment it was growing in tends to erode and dissipate. Next slide. Sequesters carbon. This is something that I'm spending a lot of time on right now. And for people who are concerned about climate change and carbon dioxide concentrations in the atmosphere, this particular species is very important. One of the reasons I'm down here this week is we're taking samples out of Lagoon Pond to measure how much carbon is in the plants in Lagoon Pond, but also in the sediments. So all plants will, when they grow, will absorb carbon, the trees, the grass, and seagrass does as well. But trees and the grass in, during the winter time or in the fall when they drop their leaves, a lot of that carbon is recycled and it goes back into the carbon cycle, the global carbon cycle. The good thing about seagrass and mangroves and salt marsh, those are the three aquatic habitats that make up something called blue carbon, is that they sequester the carbon. Everything that they're, much of what they're absorbing out of the atmosphere ends up in the sediments. And it ends up there for decades, if not longer. So we're taking sediment cores that are, I don't know, 20, 30 centimeters deep, only because we're limited by our equipment. And we're gonna carbon date them. And we'll know exactly how old that carbon is. We'll also know how important seagrass is to depositing that carbon compared to an unvegetated part of the pond. So Lagoon Pond is one of five sites we're looking at in Massachusetts this year.
Question?
Yeah?
How do you know the carbon didn't come from rotting oak leaves or other organic material that falls into the ponds and sinks to the water?
Yeah, a lot. Some of it will. Actually the isotope work that we're doing is able to distinguish between different types of vegetation. And absolutely, some of the carbon there will be from sources other than eelgrass. But because of the physical thing that I was telling you about, the leaves, which is causing things to drop out, a lot of that carbon gets focused within the meadow and it stays there. Unlike the reference site, which has no vegetation, you don't get that same depositional pattern and you don't get long-term residence time like you do in the meadow.
But the eelgrass leaves that break off and float all over the place.
Yep, they don't all end up in the meadow. And some of them will end up as detritus within the meadow and in the sediments. But a lot of the carbon that we're measuring from the eelgrass itself is actually from the roots of the rhizomes. So probably, depending on the season, somewhere from a half to two-thirds of the carbon that the plant has is stored below the ground. So it's think of the rhizome as a savings account. And the plant will photosynthesize and it will store whatever excess sugars and starch that it's producing and save it for a rainy day, literally. And it saves that all below ground.
So when a field naturally dies off, that carbon still stays in the ground?
When you say naturally dies off, what do you mean?
Well, you said that it comes and goes and some of it's natural and some of it's not. So when it naturally recedes, is the carbon still in the mud?
Right now, if the meadow thins naturally or unnaturally, there's likely to be some resuspension of that material. If it disappears completely, there will definitely be resuspension of that material. And so that's one of the statistics we like to quote people who are in this field is just from habitat loss right now globally. So let's think big picture, not just the vineyard. From mangroves, salt marsh, and seagrasses of the three, we're losing them faster than the other two habitats. We're adding the equivalent to CO2 emissions, equivalent to the country of Poland and Germany combined, each year, just from losing habitat. And obviously that's not something that's sustainable long term. So thus our interest in blue carbon and conserving these habitats. This is taken, obviously, from the vineyard. You can tell by the bay scallops. It's an important habitat for bay scallops. This is Stonewall Pond, and our friend the blue crab, who's now marching his way north. Not all the things here are friendly. Does anyone know what this species is, besides Dave Grunden? This is a little friend called the clinging jellyfish. It's an invasive, and it is found predominantly on eelgrass. And the reason it's called clinging is it actually physically holds on to the eelgrass. Well, that in itself wouldn't be too bad, except it stings. And when you disturb the eelgrass, when you're sampling it, it swarms, like kicking a bee's hive. And just this summer, was it Sage Lot Pond? Or it was one of the ponds off of Wakoit. A family of four were in swimming near eelgrass, and they got stung. And the daughter, who was 17 or 18, ended up in the hospital with respiratory distress and aches in her joints. And Dave saw these in farm ponds yesterday. They're in Stonewall. Would not surprise me if they're in a few other ponds out here. We don't know why, but we're now, whenever we're out here, even when the water is really warm, we're in full wetsuits just because of this guy.
How big are they?
They're not even the size of
a quarter.
Yeah. And they're hard to see because, as you can see, they're translucent. They have a little bit of color. You know, if the water is kind of greenish or brown, you could miss them very easily, though they won't miss you. Next slide. This was taken in Fairhaven, Mass, and it just these are all larval fish. And actually, part of the video shows these larval fish kind of swimming in and out of the habitat and using it as, again, a refuge from larger predators, including me. Up where I am, these guys are more common, winter flounder. And we get the young of the year will come in, and they love being in the middle of the meadow because it's great protection for them. But even the adults will come in and they'll look to forage on whatever they can find. Next slide. This is a winter skate, same deal. They'll come in and forage on benthic critters growing within the meadow, and they're young of the year, which are so cool when they first hatch out of those mermaid purses. They're only about this big. We'll find them in the meadow as well, using it for refuge. Juvenile sand tiger sharks. This guy's also on the video. This was taken in Duxbury in, I don't know, maybe 5 feet of water, 100 feet from a bathing beach. This guy's, I won't tell you how big he is, and I'll let you watch the video, and you can tell me how big you think he is. Next slide. And these are brant geese. Brants are very interesting. They're a smaller cousin of the Canada geese, and they originally would feed exclusively on eelgrass. In the 1930s, there was a massive die-off of eelgrass on the East Coast. 90 to 95% of the populations died due to a disease called wasting disease. The brant populations crashed. And the 5% that lived were the ones that probably figured out that they could eat baseball fields just as easily as they could eat eelgrass. But they did vary their diet to eat. Some of them now will eat shellfish and other things, but just like the Canada geese, which we also see feeding on eelgrass. In fact, out in Tajmu yesterday, they were following us around, they and the swans, trying to eat everything we were collecting. Black ducks as well will feed on the vegetation. And that's really the only things that have direct consumption. A few snails and invertebrates as well, but obviously we don't get manatees or dugongs or turtles this far north, at least. Well, turtles seasonally, but year-round. So some of the larger direct consumers of seagrass tend to be in tropical waters. Okay, the threats. All of us sitting in this room. Declining water quality in particular, and water clarity. Again, I talked about that 20% light requirement. So what causes the water to be less clear? Generally nitrogen. And where does the nitrogen come from? Well, in this system, on the Vineyard and other parts of the state, every time you flush the toilet, if you have a septic system, it's going into the groundwater and that's going into the ponds, and it has high levels of nitrogen. So that's generally the main source of nitrogen. Fertilizers from people's lawns, dog waste, some atmospheric deposition, but sewage tends to be the leading source of nitrogen. So water quality is definitely number one by far. So now we'll go down to the second and lower tier, dredging docks, moorings, boats. My friends at the Corps of Engineers, I'm always having friendly discussions with them on their dredging projects and what they're trying to dig up. People building docks over eelgrass, or putting moorings in eelgrass, or just being irresponsible boaters, which I know doesn't apply to anyone in this room. Next. Climate change. So eelgrass is a cold water plant. It actually does best physiologically at 5 degrees Celsius. And so as the water heats up, it is going to retreat north, right? And now the Vineyard is right at the midpoint of its distribution. So we probably don't have anything to worry about anytime soon. But North Carolina, Virginia area, where we're on the edge of its southern distribution, some of those meadows have disappeared, and they can't really attribute it to those first two causes, and they have seen the water temperatures increasing. So just like everything else, I mean, I'm sure you've heard about lobsters disappearing from Long Island Sound because of climate change and fish species changing their distribution. Well, this vegetation is no different. Disease, I'd mentioned the wasting disease, and it's still present, and we'll go out to any meadow and actually see it in really, really low levels. No one is sure why the massive outbreak in the 30s, which caused that dramatic decline, occurred. And there have been regional outbreaks. We actually had a massive die-off of several thousand acres in Great Bay, New Hampshire, in the mid-80s. But we're not sure what triggers that that outbreak, and people are studying that. But it is definitely an episodic threat, so it's not constant. Invasive species, so green crabs, sea squirts or tunicates, which are quite common out here. Mary Carmen of Woods Hole and myself and others have done studies on the impact of invasive tunicates on seagrass. And these, and I actually have a slide later which will show you what I'm talking about, but they're colonial filter feeders, and they look like sponges or just gelatinous material. And they encase the entire plant. And if you're a photosynthetic plant, obviously if you're encased, it's kind of hard to photosynthesize when you can't see any light. That obviously becomes an issue. All right, this is from the Bahamas. And this is what moorings can do to seagrass. So you can see the dark area here is the seagrass, and around each mooring is this donut-shaped hole. And if people are familiar with tackle and block and tackle, you have your block on the bottom, you have your metal chain, which goes up and down with the tide, and then it swings around in a circle based on the wind direction and other factors, and it scours that bottom. And you may think, well, that's not a big deal, it's a small area. Next slide. It becomes a big deal when there's lots of boats. And this is an aerial of that same area in the Bahamas, and you just look at all those little pock marks. And you know, this is the Bahamas, but I could show you the same picture from Marblehead, Massachusetts, Gloucester, you name the coastal town, and it would be the same or similar picture. Next slide. This is France. And the amazing thing in France is not only do they not believe in anchoring, they apparently don't believe in moorings. And so, next slide too. They stack up their boats. I could never imagine seeing this in the US. And this is in a small town called Cassis. And these are, I would say, your typical sailboats, motorboats. We were also in Cannes, where the boats are substantially larger and more expensive, and they're parked the same way. They're literally, the bumpers are touching. And I don't know, there was some policy decision or someone decided that that was the way to go, and they zoned areas where this is actually something that's called a calanque, which is French, a French term, and it's, think of a mini fjord, like you see in Northern Europe. So you have these large cliffs that drop down right into deep water. So there's very little shallow water on either side here. So the photic zone, or the area that would be useful for seagrass to grow in, there's very little of it, if any, in these areas. And such, they zoned these areas as, you know, boating areas. And then there are other areas in the Calanques that are seagrass reserves. People are not allowed to anchor there. They're not allowed to put their boats there. And they're zoned differently. Next slide. This is Cape Cod Bay, and people doing stupid things in boats. So this is all seagrass. Here's the channel here. And people just, you know, driving in circles and scouring the bottom and uprooting the plants as they go. Next slide. And this is what happens. This is, again, you can see this is the channel. And you can see all the scour, people trying to shortcut the channel. And that's what happens. The vegetation, you know, gets sliced and uprooted, and those scars can persist for long years, depending on how big they are.
It doesn't do the boats any good either.
No, it doesn't. So this is this was taken actually from Gloucester, not from here, but this is the invasive tunicates. These are two different species. This is the orange is called Botulotes, and this black one is I believe that's Botrylis. And underneath they're growing on, so this is an eelgrass shoot, and believe it or not, encased in the middle of that is another eelgrass shoot. So it just completely envelops it. You can see that was taken in September. Usually peaks, the invasive tunicate concentrations peak in the end of the summer into the fall. Next slide.
Why do they encase it? Are they consuming it?
No, they're just using it as a substrate. They're actually filter feeders, and they like to be up in the water column, so eelgrass actually gives them an advantage because it's up closer to their food. We've come a long way since this picture. This was the 1950s in Connecticut, and this was a bathing beach in Connecticut, and people did not like the feel of eelgrass on their legs, so they used explosives to get rid of it. Next slide. This is the historical distribution. This was taken from a study in the 40s, and it was not originally, the study was not done to figure out where eelgrass was for the sake of eelgrass. It was done by two state waterfowl biologists. So they were interested in trying to figure out where the ducks and the geese were going to go. And they had already made the connection that they were feeding on eelgrass, so they decided to map the eelgrass in order to figure out where the waterfowl were going. You notice conspicuously there's nothing on the vineyard. I don't know if that's true or not, but a lot of the places where we see eelgrass today, you know, along the North Shore, Plymouth and Duxbury, you know, lower Cape Cod, they saw it in Buzzards Bay, they saw it in the 40s. So there's a few notable areas where it was present in the 40s, and now it's completely absent. So north of Cape Ann up to the New Hampshire border, currently there's no eelgrass. And in the 40s, Merrimack River, Parker River, Plum Island Sound all supported fairly robust eelgrass populations. No longer. And the troubling thing is the Parker River is a wildlife refuge. It's fairly remote. But there's no eelgrass in there, and we're not sure why. And we've tried to restore it, or I haven't personally. Others have tried to restore eelgrass in there a couple of times and have not had a lot of success. Next slide. So the population trends. So generally it's declining. Seagrasses are declining somewhere between 1% and 3% globally on an annual basis. Massachusetts, that rate of decline is probably slower than that. So I think we're doing better than the rest of the planet, but it's still generally declining. Next slide. There are three areas of positive expansion in the state. Boston Harbor, New Bedford, Gloucester Harbor. Can anyone guess what those three things have in common? They've all spent a lot of money on sewage treatment. So obviously Boston spent, I don't know, $1 billion on wastewater treatment, moved the outfall pipe, and we've had meadows expand in the northern part of the harbor. The next time you fly out of Logan, if you go out runway 22, look down. It's growing right at the end of runway 22, about 50 acres of eelgrass. New Bedford, maybe it was mid-90s. They went from something less than a primary plant up to a secondary plant, and they did some CSO control. And so in Clark's Cove and in the Outer Harbor, they've had eelgrass expand on its own and recolonize some areas. In Gloucester, they moved their outfall pipe from inner Gloucester Harbor out into Mass Bay, They've done some CSO control. CSO is combined sewer overflows. So raw sewage. They eliminated some raw sewage discharges. And as a result, eelgrass in Gloucester Harbor has expanded. So we know generally what the problem is. We know how to fix it. We just need the will to do it.
Just a quick comment on that, Bill.
Yep.
In Charlie Costello's 20-year trend, the survey between 1990 and 2002 had Cape Hogue showing a significant eelgrass expansion, probably due to the fact that we reestablished the hydraulic connection.
Yep.
Cape Hogue. So.
There's a couple others.
Steal your thunder there.
Nope. There's a couple others. Pleasant Bay on the Cape, when they had a new area breakthrough, the Barrier Beach, the eelgrass in Pleasant Bay expanded in that little area. Those are small increases compared to the three larger ones. So there are isolated other. But the commonality is it's still due to water quality. So even those small expanses are due to improved water quality. Next slide. So there are multiple ways to attempt restoration mitigation. Seeding is one, and we were out. Danny was a very good sport yesterday, collecting seeds, Sherry and I in the water. You can collect the seeds and move them around, put them in bags, and hope for the best. And some places have had very good success using this technique. There's a story about a professor at VIMS, Virginia Institute of Marine Science, Bob Orth, who drove his boat in a serpentine pattern, distributing seeds off the back of his boat the entire way, and apparently the following year the eelgrass was growing in a serpentine pattern. I'm not sure if I believe that, but that's his story. You can also transplant seedlings. So you can take the seeds into the lab and germinate them. And generally, seeds only have a germination rate of about 5 to 10% in the wild. You can actually increase that if you take them into the lab. And we did this a year ago last winter, and we got about a 30% germination rate. And so you can then grow them to tiny seedlings and then put the seedlings out in the environment and hope for the best. The most common, though, is transplanting of adult shoots. And so envision people in scuba gear swimming around collecting literally thousands of these individual shoots, then a variety of techniques, putting them together and sticking them in the ground somewhere else. We did that for, we helped Massport with a project and collected 16,000 shoots over the course of 2 days. Involved, I don't know, about 12 hours of in-water time for me over 2 days. So it's very labor intensive. Yes?
The transplanting of the seedlings, is that a matter of dropping them into the water, or do they have to be inserted?
No, you have to secure them to the bottom. And so they become somewhat labor intensive as well. The seeds are the least labor intensive, but they're also the lowest probability of success. So it's a trade-off between how you spend your resources. Next slide. So these are the seeds that are like the size of a grain of rice, and they taste, I don't know, what did you think they tasted like?
They taste like anything, just salty.
Yeah, they're salty. They don't really taste like anything, but they're edible. In a pinch, if you ever, you know, need them. Next slide. This is one method that was developed by Fred Short at University of New Hampshire. And it's basically one end of a lobster pot, and these are two adult shoots, like this one. You put about 50 on this. This is a meter squared in area. You tie them off with these paper ties. And this is actually upside down at the moment, just to show you. Next slide. And then you walk that out into the water and you put it down. And you can, assuming that you have ample help on the shoreline, you can plant a lot of shoots fairly efficiently. Divers are expensive, and so people were trying to develop ways to reduce the amount of diving time. And so you come back 3 weeks, a month later, and those paper ties have dissolved, and you just pull the cage up. You can do that from a boat if you need to, or again, wading. The other advantage is the cage structure provides a little bit more stability. So those shoots are very unstable when they're first put in the ground, because the roots haven't really had time to secure themselves. So the cage gives them some additional stability. Next slide. So there are many challenges. As I said, it's labor intensive, and it can be, as a result, it can be expensive. If you have to pay divers, of course, me, I work for the government, so I'm free. But if you had to pay an actual diver, they're very expensive. There have been many attempts, but not many documented successes. You hear stories like Bob Worth's story about the boat. But if you go to the peer-reviewed scientific literature, there's very few papers of people showing an actual successful restoration. Next slide. The biggest thing is choosing the proper site. And one of the paradigms we have is, if there's eelgrass not growing there right now, there's probably a good reason for it. And if you don't change the conditions, you could put as many plants as you want there, and they're not going to make it. So generally, we look for areas where water quality has improved because sewage treatment has been put in. We look for areas where we know that maybe there was a disease outbreak before, or in Maine, we did a project where we knew fishermen went through with a drag. They dragged their nets through a meadow and put a nice lane right through the middle. We knew the water quality was still good, so we felt we could restore in that disturbed area without too much problem. Next slide. Bioturbation. And this, there's nothing worse than going out and picking up 16,000 shoots over 2 days, then going to another site and putting them in the ground, and coming back in 24 hours and finding them all gone. And that's happened to me a couple of times. And we went out and observed green crabs, which are an invasive species, slicing the vegetation right at the sediment-water interface. They wouldn't feed on it. So all we could figure out was they were doing it out of spite. So one of the things that people have tried, and Fred Short was on my dissertation committee and is an international expert in the restoration of this species. He came up with putting up gill nets, kind of fencing off his little meadow like you do with deer, to keep the green crabs out. Well, that worked. Kept the green crabs out. And he took me out in the boat, and he's like, I really want to show you this. This is going to revolutionize the restoration game. And I'm like, okay. So we go out in the boat, we get out to a site, and there's no eelgrass. And so there's no green crabs, but there's still no eelgrass. And we go inside the enclosure, and we look in close. And if we look very closely, we could see just the very end of several thousand eelgrass shoots sticking into the mud. Well, the cage had eliminated all the green crabs. As a result, all the sea worms came up out of the bottom, grabbed the seagrass, pulled it below ground where they could feed on the burrows, in their burrow on the seagrass. And so we manipulate the environment at our own risk. We really don't understand all the complex interactions. Obviously, the crabs keep the sea worms in check, or fish, which were also precluded from this area. So we learned some very expensive lessons. And the other part is, for most people, just getting the transplanting done is all their budget will allow. So we don't have a lot of good post-transplanting monitoring. So, and the other part of that is, people don't like to publish negative results. So no one wants to advertise and put in a scientific journal, hey, I screwed up. Here's how I screwed up, so other people can learn. It's too bad. I tried to publish one of my mistakes, it didn't get accepted. What can you do? One of the biggest things still, even with the DEP's mapping effort, is finding and reporting where seagrass is. And two summers ago, I discovered six or seven different meadows that DEP did not have on their mapping. And primarily, two of them were new, but the other four or five were too small. There were maybe a quarter to half acre, and DEP just missed them. They were in turbid water for whatever the reason. So if you find seagrass and Dave or Danny or Sherry don't know about it, well, first tell them. If they don't, it's new to them, it's probably new to me and to DEP as well. And so it's worth reporting and actually mapping, because knowing where the resource is obviously the first step. Next. Be a responsible boater. I'm sure everyone in this room is, but you know, stay in the channel. All the good stuff we talked about already. Next slide. Get involved with your local nonprofit or your Martha's Vineyard Commission or the shellfish wardens. They're always looking for help. Next slide. Take a walk. Less driving. First of all, there's enough traffic already on the vineyard in the summer. But all that exhaust has nitrogen in it, and that's where the atmospheric deposition, or part of where the atmospheric deposition comes from. Some of that nitrogen is coming from out of our tailpipes. So we're all a little bit guilty. Next slide. I didn't say this first. This is actually a famous zoologist at Harvard, study nature, not books. I have a lot of students, or I deal with a lot of graduate students, and you know, they're very well book smart, but they're not very savvy in the field, or they don't. You take them out of their book learning, they're not good observers of nature, and you know, you don't have to be a scientist or a student to observe nature. You know, we're all observers of nature, so. I would encourage everyone to do that because you live in a beautiful place. Next slide. Get wet. I want to come out here and see other people besides me swimming in the ponds. So they're there to be enjoyed. So next slide. Okay, this is what happens when you let your wife actually review your talk before you go anywhere, and she puts embarrassing photos of you in them. That's me holding Posidonia in France. And the Mediterranean in the background. We can get rid of that slide, thank you. And this is what, you know, your healthy meadow should look like. This is again Fairhaven, and just a lush, wonderful habitat. And now, if I have your indulgence, I have two short videos, 2 minutes of showing you some good stuff that grows in eelgrass or uses eelgrass. And then one that's completely non-eelgrass related, if that's okay. Hopefully this will play. All right. Okay, so this is Fairhaven, and all of these, again, larval fish are using that habitat for refuge from larger predators, larger fish. And, you know, this was maybe in all of like 3 feet of water, very shallow, but just a plethora of life not far from here.
Is that inside or outside the
earth? Outside. So this is now segueing into the Mediterranean, and again, these are now adult fish doing the same thing, using that habitat. The neat thing about this is you look at the color of the fish and the color of the seagrass, and they blend quite nicely. But when I think my mental image of what a seagrass meadow is, this is what it is. You know, lots of fish, lots of life. This is the other role. This is in Puerto Rico, and sea turtles feeding directly on the vegetation. This is a species, ironically enough, or not ironically enough, called turtle grass, Thalassia. And there's a couple of species of turtle that will feed on this particular species. It's a remora on his back. You normally see them on sharks. All right, so this is a sand tiger shark in Duxbury. And so can anyone guess how long that fish is?
12 feet.
I love that estimate. 4.5. My daughter was the same way. She's like, oh my God, Dad, that must have been a 10 footer. I'm like, yeah. Yeah, at least. But they come in and they will forage in the meadow. Now this is not eelgrass related, but because it's the Vineyard, this is a dive I did in the Bahamas and in honor of Jaws. You notice that the guy's there. He's wearing a helmet and a metal chain suit. I'm shooting the video and I'm wearing just a wetsuit and I had signed a waiver. I got bumped about 6 times on this dive from sharks who were trying to get from me to the, he has actually a chunk of grouper in that metal container. But I estimated there must have been 25 and they were all in the 6 to 7, 7.5 foot range. Predominantly females. There's, I think, 2 or 3 very lucky male sharks on this video, but mostly females. Anyway, that was just for fun. And I'll take any questions.
Yeah,